Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great. They sound even better. And guess who's here today?
It's my buddy Andy.
That's right. It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother. And over there, there he is, your friend and mine, Gnarly Nick.
Bam! Bam!
The Garlic Dragon.
That clip that opened up the show.
Yeah.
Little trivia for everybody. That was Mel Blanc's final recording as the Tasmanian Devil before he passed away.
Wow. Okay. I had no idea.
Well, put it in Wikipedia.
Good. They recorded a Pot of Thunder season two.
Cite the episode number.
There it is. It's actually Parker Chapman for those of you keeping score at home. So there you go. Nick, on your way in. Did you check if the roof was on tight?
Nope, don't care.
Oh, gosh.
Let it fly.
I'm so nervous. Well, I hope the roof's on tight because you want them. We got them.
I'm Chris. Chris, the Christmas tree. Chris, the littlest Christmas tree. The only place I want to be is with you tonight.
There he is. The breakout star of the podcast medium, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Chris L.
Who the hell was that doing all the yelling at the outset?
It was Mel Blanc.
That's all we want to talk about.
Yep. It was Parker Chapman.
Did you say
yeah,
that?
Yeah, we did. We talked about it. That's okay. Welcome to the program. Chris L's in the house. There he is. He only wants us to do one thing. And he's going to tell us what
that
is.
I'm not with it yet. Succumb to my power, my age, and my weight, all of which are considerable.
There you go. That's what we wanted. There he is. We're all on the same page now. We're ready to go. This is it. This is the last episode before Christmas.
Wow.
How about it? Another Christmas.
Another one.
Yeah.
They just keep coming.
Not just for us, but for Pot of Thunder. Another Pot of Thunder Christmas.
Well, hopefully one of our favorite guests will stop by. One of our favorite Christmas time guests
we'll see.
Will pop in. I don't know.
He's already on my sweater somewhere.
He might be on the naughty list, according to what I'm seeing a lot of comments online these days.
He's splitting his audience, definitely, but we'll see if he makes an appearance or not. I'm not sure. But you know what did make an appearance? There's a package over there, and that makes me excited because I thought this was going to be the first Pot of Thunder Christmas where we didn't get a package to open. But we'll get to that later. More on that later. But on top of said package, I heard a thud when Nick set that down. It was like, it made like the same noise as if you put a horseshoe on a cardboard box. But I think we have something there. You know what I think it is?
I can't imagine at all.
Time for a baked treat. Baked treat.
What would it be? What kind of Christmas would we have if there was no baked treat in the house today?
My all-time favorite Christmas time baked treat it is today.
All-time favorite?
Yeah, I think so.
That's a big group of words right there.
This was
all-time favorite.
One of my wife's, not really inventions, but she took a walnut kolachki recipe and turned it into walnut nut cups.
Walnut nut cups. You know what I say to that?
Oh, wow!
Yeah, it's my number one all-time.
Really? All-time? That's...
I feel
like I may have eaten these before, but I'm very excited to eat one today. So can you please pass one over?
There's a cup your nuts joke in here somewhere, but it's not coming to me.
I'm getting slow reception.
As I've already demonstrated, I'm not at the top of my game tonight.
Andy, you want a big nut cup or a little nut cup?
The littlest nut cup you have.
Well, here's a big one anyway.
Usually the cupping of nuts ceases after marriage, so it's interesting that it continues in the Jones household.
All right.
I just help myself to one of these.
No, get a load of that. Look at that thing.
That's nice for daddy.
I don't know what you guys are going to think, but it's my all-time favorite.
What's not to like?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And a big one here. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take both of my hands to cup these this nut cup.
This is not Steven Tyler in the Walking on the Edge video. One-handed covering everything and more.
No, I forgot about that. That was weird.
Yeah, nobody needed that.
When I saw that, I thought...
Don't you think I got enough bullshit on my mind?
So what's the actual cup? It's I'm getting a whiff of it.
It's all the dough is flour, cream cheese, and butter.
Mm. No cream cheese.
No sweetener or anything.
That's like you said, it's like a kolachki dough.
Yeah.
There you go.
Pretty basic, but
it's good.
You said that already too, and I completely missed it, huh? I'm just not paying attention to you guys.
No. Mouthful of nuts over there, and it's hard to.
Is it wrong?
Chris is over there shaving his balls.
Did you ever find an acceptable trimmer, Andy?
No, I didn't.
I got one at CVS recently. Works great.
Nick missed that. That was when Nick was gone, the whole saga with, I bought a beard trimmer / body groomer, and it did not have the power to cut my body hair. It just would get stuck.
Well,
so I can't even imagine what would have happened if you borrowed it.
I should tell you something.
That it's meant to stay?
That's meant to stay.
Well, it mostly has since then, so there you go.
Now, go over to CVS. I got one. I'm very happy with it.
Right, you'll have to get the make and model over to me ASAP.
Phillips Norelco. I don't know the model.
See,
but
that's what mine was, though, but it was... Is this one have like a rechargeable battery or something? Because mine had two double A's.
This one,
it had no power.
This one runs on petrol.
No, you plug it in to charge it.
Okay.
The charge lasts for quite a while. Hmm. I've had it probably for a couple months now. I've only had to charge it once.
Hmm. Well, I hope
I've shaved my balls about three times, I think. So I recommend it, man.
Good to know.
I'm extremely pleased with it. My previous one, the battery finally gave out, wouldn't hold a charge.
Yeah, that'll happen.
But yeah, no nicks or anything, even on the lowest setting, which is important when you're shaving your balls.
The previous one on the package, it said, unlimited ball trimming until exhausted.
Wow. When the exhaustion sets in, that's when you're in a bind, so to speak. But
yeah.
No, I'll I don't know if the model number's on it, but it's readily available at CVS.
I'm glad.
Hop on it.
I'm glad the charge lasts a while too, because there's nothing worse than having to leave the house with a 1.5 ball completed, and then you got to leave in 5 minutes and it's not charging.
Well, ideally you plan this sort of thing ahead. The worst thing is when you're mid trim and the battery goes out.
Yeah, the worst thing is when you have to go to work when your balls look like the guy from The Prodigy.
Well, you don't feel 100% when you're not tidied up down there. I mean, obviously this conversation doesn't apply to Nick, but. Yeah, that's the only downfall with this new trimmer is there's no battery life indicator on it. But like I said, I've charged it once and it's going strong.
Good to know. Maybe Santa will bring one for me in
2021.
There will be a new ALB.
I'm telling you, it gets my highest recommendation.
Good to know. All right, so guys. I don't know what we're doing. What's the...
We're in a Prodigy song.
Are we going to open this box first?
Let's save it.
Save it?
I don't know. Let's save it. Let's get to the music today.
Great.
I don't know. What do you think? You want to open it?
Nah, we'll save it. That's fine.
I feel like we'll save it and have a little...
I guess
the big question is, have you been drinking tonight, sir?
Yes. Only sun-kissed orange today.
So. Large orange?
Pretty large. Look at that.
The diet sun-kissed?
That's right.
So you're kicking it slomba style.
That's tonight? Exactly what I thought of.
This fine individual that we used to work with at Playboy, she would go through 2 liters of Diet Sunkist like they were going, like my trimmer goes through my ball hair, basically. Just mowing them down left and right. I really hope she doesn't listen to this episode, but
I will definitely send it to her.
It's an appropriate analogy,
I thought. It is.
She worked at Playboy.
It's not.
You can't embarrass or offend it, people who worked there.
No, they saw everything. All right, so what I was going to get at was, what are we doing on the order?
I think Andy should get another shot.
Okay.
Yeah, it's Andy.
Right. We're not skipped. No.
I'm glad I'm not. I just wanted to check.
You fucked up last week, and look what happened.
You suffered enough.
It was a slap on the wrist, I guess.
The resulting episode was a resounding success, no question about it.
That's a lot of downloads. Maybe we should talk about Disturbed more often.
What would be the name of the podcast if we changed it to a Disturbed pun?
I don't know enough of their
stuff. Yeah,
that's true.
Exactly.
Stupid pod. I don't know. That's the only thing I could think of. Stupefied. And what's the other? Down with the sickness. What's that?
I don't know.
Whatever. Down with the podcast. Down. There you go, Nick. Yeah, there's your parody. Yeah.
Download with the sickness.
All right. So it's my turn. Okay. That's good. This is exciting. Whew. Okay. Let's open up all the gear we need here. We've got 3,095 songs to choose from today.
Goodness.
So we will do that. But first, I will ask Nick to yank that crank. Nick, give it to us.
Stand by. Let's go over to the Bozo Pewter.
Gasping for air.
So that was the last time they let somebody in a state of substantial inebriation operate the Bozo.
It's true, man. It's a dangerous undertaking.
See, that's why.
Well, yeah, we've saved you from yourself.
I appreciate that.
Coming here all drunk and you think you're going to run the Bozo Pewter? It's just not how it works.
Like, that's like George Jones driving into town on the lawnmower. You guys know that one?
Yep. It's just friends looking out for
each
other.
Just guide him over to the side as best you can and defuse the situation if possible.
All right. So the first one is number 365.
Oh.
That's
how much I'm on a year.
What was it, leap year?
You were on when you made these nut cups, I'll tell you that. Yeah. These are quite good.
All right, well, I'm going to Bushwick this.
Oh, Jesus. Well, move along to the next trick.
My issue with it was I've heard the name of the band. Uh-oh. I don't know any of their music, and there was no comments. So,
well, as we point out, comments do matter.
Yeah.
They make the difference sometimes.
Yeah, quit. Don't be so fucking lazy that you don't fill out the whole form. Come on.
Tell us why we should listen to this. Help me out. Especially when it might be something a little bit more obscure than others. But okay, Nick.
Oh, I gotta get up.
Crank it.
You don't gotta tell him twice to crank it. I'll tell you that.
I keep thinking it's gonna bust into Suck My Kiss every time I hear someone say crank it.
No, that's right.
Oh boy!
No,
another.
This is a mistake to give him another chance.
This is stupid.
Oh, it's stupid.
It's stupid. I'm not doing it.
I wouldn't do it either if it's stupid.
It can go fly a kite.
Well, there it goes.
Move along to the next trick.
Are you gonna? You gonna do the Chris Brown rule? I mean, who knows what could be coming next?
Nah, I'm just gonna keep going until I'm happy.
Maybe a wise decision.
It's Christmas. We can't saddle our listeners with horseshit.
Yeah, I guess
if your first two selections were that
bad.
All right,
so why did you Bushwick the second one? You just don't want it.
I would say, Jesus. Couple hit wonder, not one of the hits. not really interested in exploring it. And again, no comments. So
yeah, well, there you go.
We should just delete the ones with no comments.
Yeah. I mean, some things are like...
lazy assholes.
Some of these things are self-explanatory, like, you know, some Van Halen or AC/DC thing.
No,
or but
no, I disagree.
Well,
tell
I guess
us why
you
submitting.
Like it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But like some of them, it's like we might not even know the song, so tell us
what's
so good.
You got to do a little,
but yeah, either
a little
way.
Salesmanship would be
agreed.
Beneficial.
Lazy bums. Jesus. All right.
Bunch of bums.
After all the work we've done over, what, almost 8 years, and these assholes can't even fill out the comments section?
Had enough.
Jesus.
Grow up.
Exactly. You leave shit blank on your tax returns, too? I mean...
This is what happens, then.
Kind of maniac are you?
Let someone else figure it out. All right. Well, here we go. Nick, once more, please. All right, let's see. What do we got? We got number 1133. Edit her out. Come on, guys. What are we doing? I can't do that to Chris.
Oh, no.
I can't do it. I won't do it to Chris on Christmas. It would be perfect, but I won't do it to you.
Wow.
You can do it if you want.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I don't care.
You might. All right, we'll try it.
Okay.
We'll see what happens.
I'm excited.
This could go on forever at this point. Yeah. Are there comments in this one?
Yeah, it seems like there's some... There's comments. There might be shenanigans because it's submitted many times by different names.
All right, tell me what it is and I might reject it if it, if it's... Or let me get up and look at it. How about that?
Okay.
Wow.
Okay.
Tag team.
So, as long as we're blowing through all the rules, why not?
Yeah, no, go ahead. It's right here.
Suspense is killing me over here.
Is that like, is that a cover?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay.
Wow.
All right. Well... This is exciting.
Now, I know what band I'm hoping it is.
Yeah.
And what is it?
I won't say, but I'll tell
you
if I'm right.
Maybe you should say.
Yeah, just say
it. What if I blow it? What if I say it and I'm right?
Well, everyone knows it now, except for you.
Yeah.
You're the only one.
Does it start with an E?
It doesn't.
No. That's what I initially thought it was. But then when he said it was submitted multiple times, I'm like, okay.
Well, I have no clue then, because I was going with a band that started with an E.
All right. Well, here we go. Time to turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
My Generation.
Off of
Stairway to Heaven, Highway to Hell.
By the band
Gorky Park.
Wow.
That's why I asked, is this a cover? Because, you know, to call an original song this would be... pretty ballsy, even for the GP crew. So,
wow.
So it's on here 19 times.
Okay, good.
This is, yeah, good. Eradicate it.
It's gone.
Yeah, Merry Christmas, everybody. Jesus.
Oh,
so,
boy.
All right. There's a lot from a lot of different characters.
Well, red is a Christmas color, so we've got that going on.
That's true. I mean, there's every... It's submitted by every member of The Who, by Raimundo.
I think I know who submitted that.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, here's... Let me read Raimundo's comment.
I was told about this.
Right, let me read Raimundo's comment, because that's good. It says, knock my business on your podcast, amigo. Well, say hello to my little friend. Apparently, this is his little friend. Yep.
All right. What is this album? Is this like their second album or what is it?
I don't know.
A compilation? Nick, you're the resident GP expert. What's the deal with this?
I don't know.
What is it? Stairway to Heaven, what?
Highway to Hell.
So is this a covers album by these clowns?
I'm looking it up right now, but I would assume if it's a cover song on an album that the title is made up of two other cover songs.
Yeah, I would think so. Oh, boy.
Let's see what other ones they covered here. Well,
is that what it is? A cover album? Covers album?
Where is it?
Is this thing even exist?
Well, I found the video because every submission says video request, so I'll play the video.
I mean, I don't.
I don't really want to watch it. Damn. I mean, I'll look at it in the distance, but I'm not going to pay any close attention to this shit.
I just want to see what all the hubbub's about because I have never seen this nor heard it.
I don't know that this is an actual album.
Well, when did it come? When did it come out?
Well, this is on their debut album. This song.
So what the hell?
This is on the one with Bang. I mean, but I.
How many albums did they have? Can we get that information?
There is one. Okay, but it's not simply by them.
What's going on?
It's a compilation
of covers.
Oh, but it's also on their album. But he chose the
cover
album compilation to submit it.
Yeah, but it doesn't even say who the band is.
Well, whatever.
Can we get some information on this?
Okay,
crap?
I got it now.
Great.
So it looks like it's all covers. I'll just give some examples here.
When did it come out? That's what I wanted to know.
This album came out in 1989. It featured bands that performed at the Moscow Music
Festival. Terrific. So is this another Doc McGee scrape some money together to get out of his legal trouble?
Most likely.
Or donate to anti-drug campaigns, even though every band except Motley Crue was gacked to the nines at this thing.
It doesn't say, but I'm assuming that that's the case.
Other question you had was how many albums did they put out? They put out four.
So this is four too many.
This is from the first one. They ranged from 89 to 98, and that was it.
Yeah, I'm sure they were a big hit during the grunge era.
What about during the Disturbed era?
Looks like they crapped out before that happened.
Just before.
So this has this album has the version of I Can't Explain by the Scorpions, which I've seen the video of before. Sweet.
Another Who cover, obviously. Yeah. Another ill-advised Who cover.
You don't like that one?
I don't like that one, no.
Boys Are Back in Town by Bon Jovi.
Okay, that it can't be worse than Everclear, but it's another one I'm not interested in ever listening to.
A little Cinderella covering Janis Joplin.
Which song?
Move Over.
Move Over. That might be interesting. What did Crew do?
Crew did Teaser.
That's a cover?
Decade of Decadence?
Tommy Bolin.
Song. Oh, right. So. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wait, okay. Is that what I'm
thinking? Is that a different teaser?
Is that one called Rock and Roll Teaser? One on Decade of Decadence?
That's Rock and Roll Junkie.
Rock and Roll Junkie. Yeah. So then Teaser. Okay.
Teaser must be the cover. I'm going to plead ignorance on the original for that. Oh. But apparently Tommy Bolin.
Here's what I do know. The accusations of shenanigans may come at us, but you saw what happened. What was that, the fourth try we got this? And the only name that was not of a known celebrity was Bob Caruso of the fabulous Caruso Brothers.
Yes.
Whose name is on the package that was sent to us as a Christmas present. This was not prearranged, but that's the way it shook out today.
And so. I got a message back in October from him. I just found it about this that he submitted.
Yes. Okay.
So he's been outed.
Read it now?
Officially. There's not a whole lot to it, but just,
I submitted this.
Can you do me a favor? And if Gorky Park's My Generation comes up, can you pick it? I submitted it from multiple celebrities with funny comments. It will be hilarious and drive Chris crazy.
Wow. All right.
So there you go. This is,
if Chris is up for it, I'm up for it.
Bob Caruso mania today.
Not much to it is exactly what I expect from a Bob Caruso comment. So.
All right.
Not surprised.
Uh-oh. Wait a minute. What's going on over here?
I can't imagine.
Uh-oh. Christmas came early. Pay attention to the screen. Uh-oh.
Whoa! Good day, Chris L. How the bloody hell are you, mate?
You're not looking too shabby. But change that stinky cologne, man. It smells like shit. Or should I say, sardines? WWE Hall of Famer here. Bushwhacker Luke. How you doing, Chris? I hear butcher me with your favorite wrestlers. Anyhow, mate, I hear you have a podcast called Thunder. Pod of Thunder. That's a great one. Well, I'm the Thunder from down under. So you've got the Pod of Thunder, and you've succumbed to your power, your age, and your weight.
Is this
now
real?
I'm going to take a shit. Merry Christmas. Now that's what I'm told to say by Andy Jones. Andy Jones must love you a lot, mate. He wants to rib you, huh? Hey, that's what life's about. Have a bloody laugh, mate. You've succumbed to your power, your age, and your weight. Now I'm going to take a shit. Merry Christmas.
What the fuck is this?
That's a good one. Yeah, I guess you and Andy have been mates for a long time. I get to say that to you. Good mates are hard to find, mate. Remember that.
That's true.
So stay friends with them forever. Because, you know, life is short. And all of a sudden, bang, and one of you could be gone. Not to say it, though.
It's also true.
To say it. Anyhow, Chris L., it's great to be on Pod of Thunder. With a little thunder from down under. And this is Bushwhacker saying one thing to you. I'm out. Whoa. Yay.
Okay, how did that come about? Is that really one of the guys?
That's him. That's
how
Bush,
did
that's
the,
Bushwhacker
how did
Luke.
That happen?
We spent all the budget for Christmas presents. For a $35 cameo.
That's
from
amazing.
Bushwhacker
that might exceed the Paul Anka and all the KISS members minus Peter Criss combined.
Yeah. It's as good as
wow.
It gets.
Jesus.
We could mine that for some clips that we can play every episode, too.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, geez. I'm blown away by that. Yeah.
So that was Luke, right?
That was Luke.
Whoa!
I take exception with one thing he said. That what did he say? That they're among my favorite wrestlers? No, they are my favorite wrestlers.
Yeah, I made that. I think
period.
I think he said it right. Did he say among? I think he meant
something like
it.
That.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I made it clear but, that it was well, number yeah. one.
Well, there is no number two. There's them and nobody else.
Mm-hmm.
Apologies to Jericho, but
hey, it's understood.
Those guys and that's it.
He in the
well, that's pretty amazing. I am legitimately. I was sitting here slack jawed watching that.
The actual video that he sent was about 2 minutes longer. I'll send you the full version, but I thought for the Pot of Thunder, I wouldn't play the full version. Basically, in the middle, he just went. He talked about his career a little bit and went down memory lane and whatnot, but. There it is. Bushwhacker Luke makes a run-in on Pot of Thunder
awesome.
For Christmas.
That is pretty amazing. I guess it's not important how you pulled it off. It's just important that you did.
That's, there it is.
Wow.
That was it.
Jeez.
All right. So, from that high.
Yeah, exactly. Now we go plummeting, swirling down the drain.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Swirling the drain.
Is there anything that you guys want to talk about before we press play on this?
I don't know.
No.
So this was on the debut album, the one that had Bang on it. Yeah. And they just re-released it on this covers album.
Yeah, apparently they just submitted one that they had already done. So it says there's a version of Purple Haze by Ozzy on this album.
Hmm. Really?
Yeah, I don't think I've...
That can't be good.
What Winger did their version right around that time or a little bit before,
probably.
Yeah. So that would be Zakk Wylde, right?
Yeah,
at that
he
point
was in the
yeah.
band at that
yeah.
point.
So Zakk Wylde on that. I don't know
maybe,
that I've heard that.
Maybe it'd be interesting musically. I just can't wrap my mind around what the vocal would be.
Agreed. That's what I was thinking.
Hmm.
All right, well then, that was a wonderful nut cup, which is also a Bushwhacker Luke specialty.
which is also a song on the first Gorky Park album.
Nut cup that or
was,
wonderful.
That
nut
was
cup.
A wonderful nut cup. The bonus track.
And that was a wonderful is in parentheses
before it. All right. Okay. Well, are you guys ready? We're gonna do this.
Oh, I can't wait.
Well, too bad. It's time for a commercial. I can't. No. We must do a commercial. We were told commercial time. So there it is. Great. What did you think of that commercial, Nick? Did you like it?
I think that company may indeed boast of the best product on the market.
Well, sounds like they did. All right. Here we go.
What is this? From one week to the next, what is this pretentious bullshit that we're witnessing here?
I don't know. This is some more wall coming down stuff.
Oh, God. Like these guys had anything to do with it. Again, the beneficiaries of Doc McGee's unfortunate brush with the law. What was he trafficking large amounts of drugs? Isn't that what he was doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
And well, these idiots got swept up in it for their, you know, plucked out of obscurity for that reason.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're marching around with what, the Russian flag and the American flag, like.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if in Russia, we probably don't have any Russian listeners, do we? But I wonder if in
zero.
Russia, zero.
I've never heard of anybody.
The biggest country on earth.
Right.
Zero. I wonder how historically relevant Gorky Park is for just having been, if I may use an analogy, for having been the sperm that penetrated the egg of Western capitalism.
Jeez. Again, you're affixing way too much importance to these idiots who got... Again, plucked out of obscurity because Doc McGee got busted trafficking incredible amounts of cocaine.
Yeah. What a deal he got, though.
Well, you know.
Should have been jailed.
Kind of like Keith Richards, who were recording this episode on Keith Richards' 77th birthday.
Is that it?
Man is still alive.
Still kicking.
But yeah, I mean, just goes to show you, you can lawyer up and show that you can generate income and line the pockets of the people who want to lock you up. You can avoid jail.
Instead of going to prison, he helped bring down communism.
It's a good trade-off.
It's a good trade-off.
Yeah. You can get on board with that. That's pretty,
pretty resourceful.
Works
on
for
Doc's
everybody.
Part.
Yeah.
He was like, all right.
Tell you what.
If you send me to jail, communism's going to keep going. But if you give me a break, I'll take it down.
A plea deal for the ages.
Give me a year. Communism's gone.
This guy might be onto something. Let's give this a shot. Unorthodox. Let's do this. All right. Well, there's a
now. Is this like before a concert or what? What is this?
I can't really tell. It almost looks like
going
news
through
footage,
the streets of Moscow, like the conquering heroes they are.
They probably weren't there. This is just some archival footage of some protest.
I can't make heads or tails of this. Nor am I understanding how this connects with a Who cover from. A quarter century previous.
It was probably
has nothing to do with
I'm gonna assume it's a rallying cry, just calling something my generation, like this is the generation that's making change. I'm assuming that's what they were going for.
Well, they missed the mark already.
Well,
they haven't
started
the song yet.
It sounds very Aussie-ish so far.
Well, like Mr. Crowley,
yeah. Perry Mason.
Perry Mason too.
Again,
yeah,
let's not make these connections. That's like equating Dave Draymond with boobs. We can't don't sully greatness by connecting these idiots to it.
As okay? you were saying that, I was like, "Who did we? Oh, boobs." That's right.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to point out, by the way, on the heels of Chris's comment just now, this is the lead track on that album.
On the covers really? Album.
Yeah, featuring, you know, giants of the time, such as Skid Row and Ozzy.
Okay, that's
and
another
Motley Crue.
Another this is terrible
the,
decision.
This is the lead track.
This is that good. That's what we're going to get
this
here.
Is trafficking cocaine and leading off an album with this song. Two terrible decisions. And
only Tim
part.
Allen and Doc McGee have bounced back from that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Not easy to bounce back from, I'll tell you. Mm-hmm. Especially Tim Allen. He didn't have that kind of clout back then, did he?
Not that I'm aware.
It was pre-Home Improvement and all that shit.
He's just stand-up comic.
Barely.
Nightclub comic, if that. Yeah, barely. You think it's too late to go back and just do a breakdown of the Bushwhackers entrance music instead?
Yeah, it is too late.
Damn. All right. Train's already left the station. Because that song's stuck in my head now. All right.
Okay, we're watching the video. It's and the credits or the accreditation has come up on the screen. My generation... Gorky Park, parentheses, original song by The Who. Thanks for pointing that out.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, people might think that it's, you know, that they're the ones who...
Yeah. Oh, my God. This, what a great song these guys wrote.
So far, I hear no resemblance to the original.
I heard a pick slide. I saw that stupid balalaika guitar on screen. And so far, we got nothing.
And you heard that snare drum noise that you hate. That,
yeah.
At least that coconut with a baseball bat, or watermelon with a baseball bat.
Cantaloupe with a baseball bat. Is usually what I say, but any of those would apply.
Yeah.
It's whereas the original just fucking cuts right in with a punch to your face, this is just weak sauce, pretentious, overdramatic nonsense. Rolling into what is got to be an awful cover. I've never heard it, and I'm probably going to wish I'd never have after the end of it. This is, these guys are clowns. Should have never, I mean, it's like, just like plucking some bum off the street and turning him into like a stand-up comic or whatever.
Or like, there's an old movie starring Andy Griffith called A Face in the Crowd, where basically that's what happens. They turn him into a TV star.
It's almost like that guy from years ago who was, you know, they're raping everybody out here. That guy who was on the news clip and suddenly he had some celebrity. That's what Gorky Park is. Some jackass who got swept up in something with no talent or anything redeemable to back it up. That's basically what they are.
Gorky Park is the sweet brown, ain't nobody got time for that of 1989.
Exactly. Exactly right.
Sweet brown.
Just the name Gorky Park, I mean, it's just the fact that they've been now featured on the show twice. It's like, again... How many albums? Four albums? Four albums too many.
Mm-hmm.
How many songs analyzed on the show? Two. Two too many.
All right, let's keep going.
So far, it sounds like fucking Addicted to Love by Robert Palmer.
Mm.
And it's like, okay, I kind of hope they don't piss all over the cover of this song. I mean, last week we talked about these chumps, Disturbed and Five Finger Death Punch, and the desecration of these classic songs that they've done. Well, here we have another one.
Yep.
I mean, this is terrible. And who's the guy with the scarred up face on the screen right now?
He becomes some sort of Marvel villain, I think, at some point in the near future.
He needs to take that new ball trimmer I bought to his eyebrows. Is what he needs to do. Jesus Christ.
It's the first thing he did after the wall came down.
Ball trimmers, ball hair trimmers became available.
He ran to the East German CVS that actually had stock of these things.
CCPS, I believe it was called. Russian youth just trimming their genital areas in the streets
with sharpened stones.
Exactly. It's like the Philips Norelco trimmers were raining down from the sky, parachuting packages, ripping them open, and just immediately started trimming their balls.
Tumbleweeds of pubic hair.
There's that famous picture. It's like the couple kissing in Times Square.
Exactly.
It's some guy crouching down with one of those Norelco.
Some guy with his foot up on the statue of Lenin.
On his head, yeah.
Yeah. So he could get a better angle.
The mirror between his legs. Yeah.
Trim that taint of his that's never been addressed in his life. Foot up on the Lenin statue. Where is that material? Why isn't that iconic?
Yeah.
Instead, you've got this idiocy. I mean, at what point are they really just going to do like their complete original take on this song? Because if they do it and it's barely resembling the original, I am not sure at this point whether I will despise them for it or actually give them some respect for doing it.
Right.
For not doing just a straight cover of it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you mentioned Purple Haze earlier. Well, on the Jimi Hendrix cover album, The Cure did Purple Haze. Great version.
And it's not an exact cover, right? It's in the style of The Cure.
Oh, yeah. But it has, the main riff is sprinkled throughout, but mm-hmm. it's not like a direct cover of it. So I don't know what to expect here, but. That was a great discussion we just had, though. Made it worthwhile.
Yeah.
The sailor kissing is the other person. That's comedy gold. Nick has been in the zone lately with the comedy.
That was excellent.
The Benny Hill. Isn't that Benny Hill? Who does the hand on the
hand
top
on
the
top of the head?
He does it to
Hill?
That old guy, yeah. But I don't know who does it. Whatever.
Isn't
anyway.
That a Three Stooges movie?
It is a Three Stooges movie, yeah. That's a Curly, I think.
No, that's apropos because these guys are just absolute stooges.
Well,
here.
This
is terrible.
You know what, though?
You have to agree.
I'm relieved that they didn't include the stutter, the famous Roger Belcher.
Not yet,
stutter.
Anyway, but...
Yeah, give it time.
I agree with you there. Because it would have been, completely pointless to do it. It was... You guys know why you did the stutter originally.
I don't.
Right?
It was an accident, right?
No. He was basically mimicking the mods and the what's the other street gang that used to follow these guys around. I can't believe
I'm
blanking on it, but he was mimicking one of those guys being on drugs and not being able to speak clearly.
I think you're thinking the Phillips Norelco gang to follow them around.
The Phillips and the Norelcos before they came together.
Yeah, before the patriarch.
The mods and the Kojaks is basically it. But
no, I had read somewhere, and probably, yours is probably true, but I'd read somewhere that it was an accident that they left in. But I, people like to say that about every song, basically, that becomes a hit.
Mm-hmm.
It just sort of happened.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
All right.
Yeah, hold on. I got to find out who the other gang here.
The Bushwhackers?
The Beatniks? I don't know.
But Beatniks is a good guess, no?
No, it's not them.
No, they were, Beatniks right. were over at this point, I think, right?
So Bushwhackers. 89?
Oh. Oh, yeah. The Mods and the Rockers. Oh,
okay.
There you go.
Right.
Well, they were over too.
They were.
Yeah, but yeah,
he actually mentioned them in the long video.
From my understanding, the stuttering was a simulation of these guys when they were on, I don't know, I guess maybe some kind of speed or whatever the fashionable drug that these guys would do in that social circle.
Interesting.
And, you know, but it was an expression of what that generation was into and their rallying cry, and you know, has nothing to do with what these fools are trying to pull off here with that stupid balalaika guitar. That thing should have been smashed immediately.
You can't smash
ideally it. Over somebody's head.
You can't smash it. It's designed.
It's unsmashable.
It's, yeah, it's like Bruce Lee. He's like rubber. You try to hit him, it just bounces off.
See, what he should have done is the Eddie Van Halen, Paul Gilbert thing. He should have run a ball trimmer over the pickup to get that you know, squealing sound like a power drill. That would have been acceptable so far.
Well, we haven't gotten to the solo yet.
No,
so.
There you go. Maybe he'll redeem himself, but I doubt it.
Dear goodness.
Yeah,
was that Parker Chapman called into the studio?
Yeah.
Someone grabbed his balls.
Yeah. He had the ball hair trimmer on too low a setting at that point.
They're gone.
Oh, they're gone. Yeah. I thought there's more than that.
No, they were. I finished.
I'll bring
those
you some
off.
More.
All right,
no problem.
No problem.
Yeah, I think he had the trimmer on too low of a setting at that point.
So how do you
grabbed onto his sack skin?
He nipped his bag,
not in a good way.
So how do you feel about pretty much a different chorus altogether? There, throwing in a chorus where really my generation doesn't really have a chorus, right?
Not
really.
You could
the verse is what it is.
Yeah, the whole.
So they what? How do you feel about them putting in some effort there and? Doing a pretty, you know, he's got the hair metal 80s kind of guitar riff in the background, kind of all reimagined. You could tell there's some work put into it.
Some work.
What do you think? I mean, it doesn't come off as lazy to me because there's a whole new chorus there.
I'll give him some credit for the, like I said, I was undecided about, because clearly this is not just a direct rendering of the original.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give him a little bit of respect for that, but it's just so terribly executed and cliche ridden that
it's of the time for sure.
I don't care if it's of the time. These guys are clowns. They should have never. We shouldn't be talking about them.
Yeah.
Well, with the immense cultural impact that they had.
The thing they had going.
It's impossible not to.
Yeah, this is an abomination. Again, another unfortunate outcome of Doc McGee's drug trafficking foibles. I mean, this might be the worst of them all. All the people who perished from doing the cocaine that Doc McGee was trafficking, this is a worse outcome.
Wow.
Apologies to the families, but unleashing this on the world?
Worse.
Devastating. Unacceptable.
Let's keep going. Why are you all 50 feet away? So try and dig while we all see. I'm not trying to cause a big sensation.
I'm just talking about... And this mumbling of talking about my generation between each verse, it's like, it's terrible. This is your brother Jay had this album, right?
Yes. Can
we
yes.
talk about
it's
that?
It's still in mint condition, too, by the way.
Is it?
As it yeah, should be. It should have never been listened to.
All copies.
It still looks fantastic.
Great. Excellent. Was he like into this, or do you have any recollection of his
not too
response
much.
To this song?
I don't think it was this song at all. I think that was, you know, back in the days where you didn't always buy the single.
Mm-hmm.
You bought the album because of the lead single,
mm-hmm.
and just rolled with whatever else was on it. I don't remember ever really listening to any other song on this album.
It was then Bang.
Bang was it, yeah. Yeah.
And then you just hit Bang, repeat.
Basically, yeah. Yeah, so I mean, I don't remember how into it he was.
I don't either. But I remember Bang.
But he got
being
it.
Being a thing, so. But the Bang thing was happening, but I don't remember.
It happened.
It was not an album listen.
No, I wouldn't say so. Not from my recollection.
I know we're not talking about the video too much, but it has a little bit of a cult of personality.
Please
but
don't.
Just take
that back.
Well, what I mean...
Edit that out, whatever. No.
What I mean is
no.
There's scenes of these, like... these soldiers
See,
marching.
Is,
they're cutting it. It almost seems like it's inspired by, like, they watched that, and they're like, let's do that, where
well,
we cut
is...
in these armies of these tyrannical governments marching.
See, this is why we shouldn't have watched the video. That's might be the most unfortunate comparison that's ever been made on this show. Do not, again, don't sully greatness by connecting them to this crap. In any way.
All right. Let's keep going.
My generation.
Nobody wants to see this crap. Right. This newsreel footage, you know. It's mm-hmm. like this is 80s rock. You want to see hot chicks and partying and stuff. Instead, you got some guy with a rocket launcher here. War scenes. Nobody wants that.
I'm waiting for the time in the video when Nikolai Noskov comes out wearing his body glove gear. Strips from his traditional garb into neon colored spandex.
What's that guitar player's name? Wasn't it like him, Vernon Reed, and Joe Satriani on the first G3 tour or something
yeah,
like that?
Exactly. Alexei Belov.
There you go.
Yeah. Ooh, I didn't realize they replaced their singer after their first album.
Well, they should have replaced everybody in the band with nobody and just caused the band to cease to exist.
All right. That's
who are these guys to replace anybody in this band? Oh, you're not good enough to be in Gorky Park. Get out. We're replacing you. It's like, what kind of delusions of grandeur do you guys have about yourselves? You're actually going to kick somebody out.
Yeah,
it's like you're five slugs off the streets of Moscow, and you're suddenly making personnel moves. Get out of here!
Well, you know when after Bang broke over in like parts of Siberia where they never saw the band, they actually had Frank Beard and Dusty Hill were in that Gorky Park.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
there you go, tying it back.
What are you doing?
I was just
there?
Looking at why he left the band.
He's admiring the Gorky Park lineup.
Yeah, pretty much. That's it. Yeah, it seems
what
like
is
maybe
that guy,
he left.
Now, I don't have my glasses on. It looks like this guy's hoisting the Stanley Cup almost. Is that what's
he's
happening?
He's got a bazooka over his shoulder.
Okay, I can't tell.
That's when they first let the Soviet players in the league.
That's I forget his first name. That's Fetisov, I think, that we're seeing.
Yeah, possibly any number of the Russian Five could be on there.
Think?
Oh, that was, that whole sequence was just god awful. Everything, everything since you stopped at last was possibly the low point in music history. That was just
you didn't like any of it, not even the beginning where it was kind of spaced out.
Nope,
no,
all crap. These guys are just ham-fisted clowns who should have never been given this opportunity.
Because there's no question that ending passage was too much. It just it was nonsense and didn't even go with what they were playing. But not even giving them any credit for the beginning, huh?
Zero credit. They deserve none. Wow. They should have never. Basically, these guys are the musical equivalent of the Donald Trump presidency. Should have never happened. Should have never been given that opportunity. It should have never happened. Wow. Period. And that's the best analogy I can make.
Wow. All right.
And again, there are people who like Gorky Park. There are people who like Donald Trump. But neither of those things should have happened. Trump was already on people's radar as a celebrity. But him becoming president, these guys becoming known in any way for music, neither of those things should have ever happened.
Wow. All right.
Abomination in both instances.
What was it? Sorry, we had a distraction.
We're not
here.
Listening to the song. Right
No. But we'll share it with the listeners next week. But
I have to go back, unfortunately.
Why?
Because I think we missed something musical, and that's what we're supposed to be discussing. What are they playing here after the solo? There's this. Is this like the Russian national anthem or something? It's a familiar when it kicks in. It's familiar. Jesus. From like
is that that's what they were playing at the beginning, right?
Yeah,
but I don't what know what that's I don't something. Know what it is.
Is it the Perry Mason theme by chance?
It sounds familiar from Commodore 64 World Games. I can't think of what.
I was just gonna say that.
I can't think of what champion.
I never let the Russians beat me in that game, so true. I never heard their anthem.
What did
the
he say?
Did he just say?
He said, "Hey, that's my ukulele." Hey, that's what
sounded like. Something about an idiot. It sounded like
he's yelling at the guitar player.
You over there, go shave your balls, maybe.
It was Nikolai L on lead vocals, removed from the band after one album
for refusing to shave his balls.
Doodle. Not going to do it again.
No
repeats. All right. So there you have it from 1989. A couple different releases. That album's called Gorky Park, right? So It's self-titled.
Yeah.
1989 release. And that, what was it? Stairway to Hell, Highway to Heaven.
Yeah,
whatever they went with.
Yeah, the Michael Landon tribute album.
Yeah. All right, guys. I'm opening both clips because we're going to need them. Sweet Surrender or Kick in the Crotch?
I think you should go first.
Oh, man, do I have to?
Shouldn't you? Since you picked it?
I should. That's usually what I do.
You like to do that.
I like to do that to you guys.
Ugh. Well, now the shaver's on the other side.
Shaver's on the other ball. I'll kick it. I'm kicking it in the crotch.
Bang. It's a humiliating kick in the crotch!
I'm going to say something that's going to make everyone mad. Chris might walk out of the room.
Oh, my.
I kicked this song in the crotch. I think it's better than the original.
Oh, get out of here.
The original is one of my least favorite popular rock songs of all time. I don't know why I hate it. Never liked it. Always hated it.
I think I remember that.
Yeah.
I think I remember you saying that years ago.
So the fact that it's unrecognizable, well, not totally, but in some cases.
It's pretty unrecognizable.
Makes it better to me because never liked that song. And the stutter thing, one of the worst decisions. I don't care what the creative inspiration was behind it. One of the worst decisions in the history of music. Stupid. Bad idea. Would it be?
Well,
it'd be fun to do at a concert.
It wasn't a bad idea because it's been talked about and discussed for decades. Well,
then everything we've said over 7.5 years is nullified if success is the reason that it's good.
Does it help that it's ultimately a faster version of the verse of I Love It Loud? It's the same thing.
A little bit. Yeah, maybe that's what it is. But again, it's still a kick. Just never was a fan of the original, so there you go. Not a Who fan. They've got nothing for me.
Yeah, I think we've discussed this before, right?
I've tried. Still trying. Maybe one day it'll just kick in, and I'll be like, oh, I get it now, but nope, not a fan.
No, I'll give this a major kick, obviously. Major kick. Okay. This is one of the worst things I've ever heard. No question about it.
It's a humiliating kick in the crotch!
I mean, I'll give the Who their due respect. Kids Are All Right was one of those midnight movies that we always went to see. That Song Remains the Same, movies like that. But for some reason, I can't get super excited about the Who. They don't really get me going like a lot of other bands do. Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to go so far as to say that my generation is terrible. It's an iconic song, bass solo, all that stuff. Everything about it, just given the times and the expression, you know, possibly this will probably piss off Andy, but quite possibly the first punk rock song of all time. I can't get super. I don't seek out Who music to listen to. You know, a couple months ago, I was at our annual gathering with the old high school and college crew, and we were debating whether Live at Leeds is the greatest live album of all time, and I was probably the only one with a dissenting opinion.
Really? Yeah.
And I can appreciate the incendiary nature of the performance and the quality of it, but just something about the Who just doesn't fire me up like so many other bands do. But I'm not going to go as far as to say the ridiculous things that Andy has said. But,
all right.
Yeah.
Well, Nick?
Oh, boy.
I'm going to give it a very slight Sweet Surrender.
Yes, he did it.
It's Sweet Surrender! Hell yes!
And the main reason mm-hmm. is because it didn't occur to me going into it that my generation really doesn't have a chorus.
Mm-hmm.
And just the fact that they put one in there, even though I'm not saying it's awesome...
Mm-hmm.
That endeared itself to me. So I like that. It's not, I'm not going to go listen to this again, probably. Yeah.
God,
but,
I hope not.
But, I mean, it's, and I actually like the original version of the song.
Okay.
And I think Live at Leeds is really good.
Well, of course it is.
Not the greatest live album ever, but,
yeah.
It's got a great opening track. It's got a lot of great stuff on it. It gets weird. It gets into the...
Yeah, it's got all the things that I appreciate. Yeah. But I was surprised at that almost everybody else at this gathering almost like it's the secretariat of live albums. They just flat out announced it as the greatest live album ever, and there was no debate about it.
No, I would disagree with that as well.
And I couldn't really...
But I think it is really, really good.
I couldn't really just sit there and counter it with what I think is the greatest live album of all time, because there are so many great ones. But I know that isn't it, is basically my take.
I mean, I hold it in high regard.
Course, so do I.
Our buddy Mondo let me borrow it years ago, and I was like, wow, this is really good.
Yeah.
But
the expanded version has got a lot of cool stuff on there.
When is it from?
Late 60s.
I thought it was 70. I thought it was early 70s. I could be wrong.
Could all be right. 70.
Around there.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's when they start to get weirder. Right. It's like right around... Right before it or right around that time.
When was their first breakup?
Oh, I don't know.
First breakup?
Yeah.
Moon died in 78, but they didn't break up. But
then they have like a farewell tour.
Yeah, 82, 82. 83.
Okay. All right. Well.
So, yeah. That's
for you, Nick.
Well,
hey,
there were things about it that I didn't care for.
Yeah.
But I thought, and in all seriousness, the fact that this probably, and it was probably very, very much calculated to do this, but you had this historic moment going on, and this was their way of getting in on that, which people do. Let's face
it. That's what people do.
That is what everybody, what is social media at this point? It's a way for people to try to identify them or align themselves with
something,
what's going on.
Well, yeah,
and
again,
they want everybody to know it.
These guys shouldn't have been afforded this opportunity, but they were, and they attempted to make the most of it. And you know, I can't fault them for that. They should have just never been plucked out of obscurity.
Well,
no talent, you know. Oh. File them with Blake Shelton, Luke Bryan, Dave Draymond, and Gorky Park.
All members.
DJ Khalid also on your list?
Until the Geico commercial.
Oh, okay.
Redeemed himself with that. He doesn't have any talent as a musician or a musical entertainer, but he's got some comedic chops.
So you're telling me that Gorky Park has a chance when their Geico commercial comes out to redeem
himself? Man, it did it for Rat.
Yeah.
You know, Gorky Park had to be on that short list.
I expect them to do the same thing that they did when they were given this opportunity, utterly fail to rise to the occasion. Reveal themselves to be the hacks they are, and nothing. There's not going to be a DJ Khaled moment, Geico commercial moment for these goofballs. It's not going to happen.
Did Europe have the resurgence that Rat had from their Geico commercial?
Not as much as I'm
much.
Aware of.
No, me neither, but their commercial was better. Oh, well. All right. Well, if you agree or disagree, I don't know what to tell you.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Yeah, these Pinkos could play, though. let's end it with that.
Yeah, there you go.
No, they couldn't. What do you mean? What? Where's the indication that they could play?
Well, yeah, this is a very slickly produced thing, so it's hard to tell.
Well, let's get down to the important business. Nick has been like a child on Christmas Eve, picking at that box over there. I hear tape getting... Yep. Look at that. The whole time.
So are we to understand that was this ship drop shipped directly to us from Amazon, or was it repackaged in an Amazon?
It was repackaged in an Amazon box.
Okay, I'm a little less excited about it. But
you can put your gloves on.
Should I do?
Please do. Here we go. This is the big time for us.
I see a $5 bill right on top.
I think that's for me. That's for me because I mailed him something. Okay, he's paying me back. Andy's. Gave him some Flying Aaron CDs on the house.
Sending cash through the U.S. mail. It takes balls.
It does. Look at that. We've got some artwork.
Ooh.
A Pot of Thunder Christmas.
That's nice. Look at that. It's like a Christmas ornament drawn in, is it colored pencil or marker?
Looks like crayon.
Okay.
Somebody's offspring do that?
Could be, yeah.
That's what I'm guessing.
One of the fabulous Junior Carusos?
A joint venture.
Nice.
Although it's signed BC, so I'm guessing Bob did it.
Either that or all the surviving members of Body Count helped him.
Well, there's a whole letter on the back of this. Did you miss that?
I see it now. And I see another letter. Oh, this is for Andy.
Oh, special letter for Andy.
Yeah.
Let's not share that.
Uh-oh. Let's see what that says. Whoa.
Should I read this?
I'm making the Larry Hagman face.
Did we all get letters? Or?
No.
Okay.
No,
you want me to read this?
Yes, sure. Please do.
All right. I will refrain from giving out his home address, which is at the top of this letter. We've got dear fellas. Really love the show. I typically listen during long walks to relieve stress, and the laughter is quite effective. When my brother first introduced me to the show, my last expectation is that I would become friends with you guys, but I did. That's news to me, but... Continue reading here.
Oh, boy.
So I wanted to send you something special to show my appreciation. Please open your presents now. Okay. And read the rest here for the backstory.
Okay. So they're wrapped. These
are you opening?
They're wrapped. No, this one says to Nick.
My father's retirement...
I don't care about the rest.
Can I finish?
I hope so.
This is the good part. My father's retirement passion is woodworking and making things for others to enjoy. So I showed him the pot logo and asked if he could make something for you guys. Knowing how much my brother and I enjoy the show, he was happy to.
Oh, man.
After making the woodworking piece, he had the idea to mount it on a real vinyl record. So I gave him ones from ELO, Disturbed, and Ghost. Hopefully that does not ruin the gift.
I think it's...
Only kidding, of course. My mom pulled random ones from a box and has no idea what they were.
Wow.
Hope you have a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, Bob Caruso and family. CBBS rules.
I have to say, this is incredible.
Oh, it's even got
amazing.
Got a little hanger on the back.
I had no.
It's ready to go.
I did not expect this in any way.
Wow.
This is phenomenal. Wow.
Yeah, that's really cool.
On the back of mine, it says Merry Christmas 2020 to Andy ALB Jones from Bob Caruso and family. CBBS rules. Caruso Brothers. This is awesome. We'll post pictures of these.
These are really cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's got a little hanger thing on the back.
Paint job on there.
You may have said that.
Yeah. Beautiful. We're not worthy of this.
No. I thought it was not to be. I won't say anything.
My goodness.
I mean, this is an impressive rendering of
our
season 2 logo.
It is.
It's almost exact. It is exact, basically.
Wow.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
See again, the Caruso patriarch, this masterful woodworker, wallows in obscurity while Gorky Park enjoyed some level of notoriety. There's just something not right about that.
Yeah. The world's not fair. But
oh, yeah, that's very true.
Well, I have to say thank you so much to the Carusos.
This
Mr.
is going
Caruso
up in a
senior.
Place of esteem in my man cave, no question about it.
Agreed. Beautiful. We're all amazed here.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we're not worthy of this type of gift, but we'll take it, of course.
Absolutely.
And thanks. Nice to know we made this kind of impact on people. Makes it worthwhile to show up here every week and put out this show.
Yeah. We get those messages once in a while, and it's like, oh, yeah, we're actually doing something that people care about. Feels good.
Yeah, we got a nice one today from Mr. Mesler, who I'm starting to worry about him a little bit.
He is head to toe in Pot of Thunder gear.
Which, that's what I'm worried about, is like the chafing that will be soon to result in his nether region. He's going to have to keep tabs on that. He's going to wear that thing down to a nub if he's not careful. That's what happens when you don Pot of Thunder merch.
Agreed.
So, and if you don't have any, you should go buy some.
There you go.
Go to the website under merchandise.
It's a lot to choose from.
Are those Charisma robes still available? Has anybody checked
that? I don't
know.
I've not. I have not checked. That was a ridiculous item, and I know it was purchased.
Yep. I remember the pictures.
Yep.
Yeah, this is really nice. This is really, really, really nice.
Beautiful.
Yeah. The old man's got talent. Mm-hmm.
Tell me, guys, you up for a yard?
Why not? Yeah. It's Christmas.
All right.
Swing away.
Yes, chief.
Let's try to do it lightning round style. In honor of the lightning bolt logo that was so wonderfully reproduced by the Caruso patriarch. Any luck over there, Andy?
Yeah.
Are we still getting yards of questions? Are we still in good shape there?
Yeah, we got a few this week. Mm-hmm.
Alright.
What are you talking about?
Oh, boy. You know it's good when Andy's talking back to the yard of questions.
Yeah. All right, here we go. This one comes to us from our pal, Steve Coldwell. We know Steve.
Yes, we do.
Steve says, "Dear Boners, one of the weirdest things about this year has been realizing exactly how much I miss having a couple hours alone in the car each day, especially Monday mornings. In fact, I'd say that falling behind on Pot of Thunder has been the only downside of working from home since March 15th. But I buckled down, and I'm submitting this Yardo questions in celebration of being caught up on Season 2 for the first time in 9 months.
Wow.
I'd also love to hear Andy weigh in on these. Ooh, maybe a Christmas treat. We'll see.
Oh, boy.
All right, let's see what we got here, Steve. Thank you, Steve. That's very nice of you to say that. I feel the same way. I haven't been able to keep up with podcasts that I used to listen to.
I don't have that many right now.
Yeah.
I got a few of our friends who do them. I like
them. And you're behind or you're caught up?
I'm behind on just about all of them. But,
yeah, right?
But I do enjoy them.
Yeah. All right, question one. What's the weirdest song that you regularly find getting stuck in your head? I ask because, despite having never heard the original, I've lost track of how many times I've woken up at 4 a.m. with Mary the Podcast stuck in my head. Weirdest song you get regularly stuck in your head.
First one that comes to mind for me is Peekaboo by Devo.
Hmm.
So, is it just the song, or is it the video of the crawler crashing?
Is that the one with the crinkle fry or whatever that is? Yeah.
Or what's the long cylindrical donut?
Long John?
Long John crashing into the hole of the conventional donut.
Something like
Brilliant
that.
Brilliant stuff.
Yeah, that...
Brilliant stuff.
That one comes to mind immediately.
Hmm.
I've talked about this before on an episode that was devoted to this song. I can't explain it, but I would say ever since 1980, probably at least once on a daily basis, the drum breakdown from Dragon a Track by Queen clicks into my mind. So I can't. Funny. It is so bizarre, but from the first time I heard it, probably every day of my life since then, 40 years, at some point during the day, that drum breakdown will click into my head. I can have no explanation for it.
Funny. Weirdest.
You, Andy?
I just thought of one. It's one that only Nick knows because it's something that Nick and I wrote together. And we performed it at the cafe Chris owned with his wife back in the early 2000s. And what we used to do back then was for these Thursday night open mics, Nick and I and a cast of characters or any combination of would come up with something different to do each week. Instead of like honing a craft or perfecting some kind of act or whatever, it would either be, it could be songs, it could be a weird sketch, it could be a stand-up thing. But I think it was in, I don't know, not defiance, but whatever. Like, the majority of the other acts were acoustic guitars. Do you know what I'm going to say? What song?
I think I
maybe
know. Yeah.
So we're like, oh, you know, being the brilliant people we were, like, let's do like a thrash hardcore thing. Yep. So we wrote four songs.
And I remember how well it went over.
It
too,
did.
Surprisingly.
I thought it was going to be like, in my mind, it was like, this will be annoying and obnoxious. But no, it actually went over. But anyway, we wrote four songs for that because we weren't, you know, that was the idea, was always to do something new. And one of the songs was about singing the song so you could listen to it while you cut the grass.
Yeah.
I swear, that's like a couple times a week I sing the whole song to myself. I have to find the demo of that we made.
I think didn't you ask me to just write lyrics?
I think so.
And then you wrote the music after it.
And I just pieced them together.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. That's the one.
Yeah. Yeah, cuz that was my move. Yeah. Back then. It still is actually. Got
to
have some music on when
to
you
cut the grass.
Grass.
Yeah. Yeah. So the chorus was, sing it now in order to listen to it while I cut the grass. So there you go. If I could find the demo somewhere, I'll post it. But I don't think it's going to be an earworm for anybody but me.
Never know.
You never know. Question two. Is there a song or even whole album that one of you has ruined for one of the others through overplaying? I don't mean the classics you never need to hear again, thanks to rock radio, but a song that one member of Pot of Thunder has ruined for another.
I mean, it'd probably be between me and Andy because we lived together for years and years, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, unless it's happened, unless we've ruined a song for Chris, I don't know.
See, I feel like he said through overplaying, that would apply to me and Nick, but I don't think that would apply the other way. But maybe there's another way we've ruined something for Chris. I don't know.
Through overplaying.
Yeah, I don't think I've ruined anything for you guys. We've never really like hung out together and listened to music together. So
no, and when we do, it's Donald Isley usually.
Yeah, nobody's ruining
that.
That's
not ruined.
No.
I'm going to say Stone Temple Pilots, but I don't know if ruined. I'm just thinking played a lot.
I mean, I can think of some stuff that I remember Andy listening to a lot that I didn't like, but I didn't like it off the bat.
What's your problem, dude?
Congo Shock stinks.
I got to buy that album. That's going to be my Christmas present to myself. It's on, what is that website? Bandcamp.
Boy.
For like $5. That was good.
What can I tell you?
I'm going to get that. I'm going to buy it today.
That was over listened
to. Congo Shock. It was called Dick Triple Flip, the album.
Man,
that's
one
like
song. That one song about the girl wearing the satin. Or the worst song ever written.
I hope that comes up next week.
The worst song ever.
Next week, every number on the list is going to be that song.
I don't even know the name of that song.
I think
but
it
man,
might have been satin.
Man,
I don't
is
know.
It terrible.
Whatever, dude.
Woo!
I thought that was good. It was a ska band from Phoenix or Scottsdale or something. I forgot. Arizona somewhere. Late 90s. Or whatever, mid-90s probably when it came out.
Oh, boy.
Nick had a tape that he used to play all the time that I hated.
Okay.
It was a single that was a promotional, or whatever, a couple song promotional.
I think I know
by a band
mean.
Called Stanford Prison yep. Experiment. Who did they open for?
A buddy of ours caught their demo tape that was thrown out. They opened for Rage Against the Machine in 96, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And I liked both of the songs on that album, and I ended up getting a few of their albums.
You did.
I didn't
realize that.
For super, super cheap on Amazon.
Way later.
Like, no album covers. I just, like, oh, this is, like, $1. Mm. Like, okay, I'll get it. But I really, yeah, those two songs on there, I think it was So Far, So Good, and You're the Vulgarian.
I remember that, that's right.
You didn't like those, huh?
No, maybe I would now, but at the time, I wasn't into it.
I don't know, for that style of music, those for some reason, that band...
They were all right.
That band got through to me.
All right. Nothing, Chris. Nothing applies.
I can't think of anything.
Like that's horse shit?
Well, you could technically say that you ruined Gorky Park for me.
There you go.
Because you listened to it at one point and have now twice forced me to listen to it.
That's overplaying it.
Although this was my decision. I took a look at it.
Yeah.
And it worked out because it was, you know, transitioned nicely into the wonderful gifts we received here, but I can't think of anything in reverse that, you know, I've subjected you guys to that you don't like.
Yeah, I don't know. Don't think it's really happened.
Maybe the Cult? I don't know. I mean, I know Andy's not a fan of the tambourine playing. And
I'm not a non-fan. I just make fun of that one thing. I have no problem with the music. It's just a... one little
didn't you say at one point that being in a Cult tribute band ruined it for you?
Kind of did.
Yeah, that does happen.
I consumed way too much Cult music and way too much detail. I had to step away from it for a while.
I had the same thing with the Faith No More tribute band. I didn't listen to the real thing for easily over a decade after we did a show where we played it front to back. And it was a CDR burned copy because I had the cassette back. It was Jay's, our brother. But we had the cassette forever, and then I had a burned CDR. After the show, on the way home, I threw it out the window. Didn't want to hear it ever again.
It's too much. I don't know how these guys are. I mean, it must be just, you know, the excitement of playing for crowds and making a little scratch, but eventually it's just like, I can't listen to this anymore.
Tribute band's a hard thing to do. Like, for yourself mentally.
I
could see cover band being fun. You change it up all the time.
Well, but let that be a lesson, even if it's any sort of cover. Chances are you might ruin that song.
Oh, yeah, that too.
There are a lot of great songs that I really don't listen to anymore, and I think it's because...
You learn it?
I learned it and played it.
I agree with you. You learn how to play it, and you're like, that's it?
Well, I don't. I can't even explain what the phenomenon is that makes you not want to listen to it as much anymore.
Oh, you pick it apart, and you, you know... You get too deep into it, and then you just like I've been picking this thing apart and going back and forth in segments. It's like I don't want to hear it anymore.
Yeah, it's not it's not fun anymore. It becomes like a work thing, some kind of task for you.
Exactly.
All right, question three. I'm sure this gets covered in the final days of season one. I'm up to Mainline as of this week, but I'm curious why Dr. Nick retired at the end of the Kiss run. I can't help but think he would have had so much to say during the Disturbed episode and so many others.
Oh, so many. I think we answered that before.
I
could do it again.
I know we've talked about it, but I don't know if it was a Yarrow question.
I think it was.
And also, for the record, it wasn't the end of the Kiss run. Wasn't it way before?
Or
did he come back?
Nick would know.
Wasn't around for a good long while before that. Yeah. But I don't really remember. Didn't he have something to do with the ending?
At the ending he did, but I mean, spoiler alert.
I think, we'd said it before, so I'll just kind of restate it. When we went to dinner the first time to talk about, actually
the only time we've had
talk
a conversation
about what we were going to do on this podcast. I had my little notebook that I brought with me, and I had a few ideas, and one of them was psychoanalyzing the subject, who would be, if it were a real person actually saying or thinking these things that are being said in Kiss songs, what would be wrong with them?
Like, I got love for sale.
Yeah, or just
what,
so
you
many.
You talk about what that person's really going through mentally.
Yeah, yeah. So that was just like, okay, like we could kind of break into that and just do that briefly every episode. It turned into the three of us doing that for most of the episode anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of fixating on the lyrics and creating our own storylines and speculations and things. So really wasn't...
Are you saying everybody became Dr. Nick?
He kind of
stole the shtick.
We're
a Dr. Nick tribute act.
Basically,
three of us.
Yeah. No, that's from my perspective, at least. That's what went on there. So it really wasn't necessary.
Yeah.
There was some bozo who really hated it too, who said so on Facebook one time.
Oh, really?
I remember that.
Well, I don't think that would have been the reason to stop.
No, that wasn't the reason it stopped.
Absolutely.
But there was at least one person who didn't like that.
Well, one person.
But I think that guy
ruined it for everyone.
That guy probably puts his underwear on backwards. So I'm not really worried about it.
That happened in high school, where this guy who I shouldn't say anything about him. God bless him. But he was like an awkward man, large guy. Freshman year of high school, like a big, grown, hairy man who was kind of a goof in a good way, but just, you know, jovial goof, put his underwear on backwards and then in front of everyone said, "Oh shit, I put my underwear on backwards." Like, you didn't have to say it. You could have just...
No, well, he was performing.
Yeah,
it had to be.
I don't think so. I think it was just the nature of this guy. But uproarious laughter when you saw the butt part on the front.
So juvenile,
yeah,
but hysterical.
Yeah,
it's not funny, but it's hilarious.
Yep. Steve says, "Congratulations on keeping Pot of Thunder going this year, week after week, regardless of everything going on across the country. Taking care of your families and figuring out how to do your actual jobs in the middle of a pandemic. It's a bigger deal than you might think, especially to your listeners. Happy holidays to the Lathrop and Jones families, and best wishes for a happier, healthier new year, Steve Caldwell."
Same to you, Steve.
What a guy, Steve.
Yeah, geez, the heartwarming sentiments coming at us today.
It's what we need.
I love it.
Yeah. thank you very much, Steve. I just got another. Because I read the Yardo questions. We used to print them out. I read them off my phone now. And I just got a notification for a new comment on the Disturbed episode on YouTube.
Oh, boy.
I'll read it to you. John Puckett says, "The hardest I've laughed since the VH Up for Breakfast episode." So there you go. Thank you, John.
Good. We thrive on positive reinforcement, so keep the... kind comments coming. Drop a review on Apple Podcasts. All that stuff makes a difference.
If your dad's good at making stuff, get him on the case. Thank you again, Caruso family.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
Mike
we're
and
not
Bob
worthy
and
of
all
these handmade gifts, but we will gladly accept them and keep doing what we do, and Merry Christmas to everybody who celebrates, and appreciate you guys listening, as always.
All right. Well, there you have it.
Wild hickory nuts roasting on an open fire. There's always a jackass nipping at your nose. Worthy. Great Expectations being sung by a choir. My mother is beautiful and I love
Eskimo. That's the first thing.